Hello, welcome to the Checkpoint this week, and we are checking on National Water and Sewerage Corporation. With us today is the General Manager of Kampala Water, and this is Engineer Mahmoud Lutaya. Thank you for allowing us to check on you this evening.
Thank you for giving us the opportunity to, I think, discuss a very important topic and also being able to give more information to our customers.
Okay. Engineer, is all well here at Kampala Water?
I think for us, the only way we can assess whether all is well is when our customers are happy, especially if people are getting water reliably. And I think when you look at all things in Kampala, all is well, apart from a few areas that are being challenged right now, and we've been communicating, especially the western part of Kampala, where we have a few water supply challenges, but we've given assurance to our customers that we're doing everything possible to have them sorted, and we're sure by next week, also that will be history, and all will be well everywhere then.
Okay, about the billing.
Yes.
Is National Water billing their customers right? And here in Kampala, are you doing it well?
I want first to go back. I think when you talk about National has been around for some time.
Yes.
And I think over time, and customers have testified, it's the one institution that they were very, very confident about the bills that we'll give our customers. When you look at our motto, customer is the reason we exist as an institution. We are aware that the only way you can exist is when you have the full trust of the customer. And our bill becomes very important. We put in place so many things over time to guarantee that by the time the bill comes to the customer has all the confidence that they have the right bill, they receive the right bill, they have confidence in. And that is also reflected in the fact that over time, our customers have been genuinely paying because they believe the bill they're receiving is correct. And that hasn't changed. Now, along the way, like any system, you're going to have challenges, yeah? Like I think the recent discussion that we've been having.
Yes.
But that doesn't take away the fact that all the bills, or most of the bills that the customers are receiving are very genuine, and the system hasn't changed significantly.
Yes, the recent challenges that you're talking about have been also our, they've caught our camera, the eyes of our camera, and one of those challenges is the fact that some bills were getting inflated, and we had that story running. So are you billing the customers right?
Like I said, we're billing the customers right. And now, let me just come why I say that.
Yes.
And like any system, we have systems in place.
Mm.
And there could be cases, because see, remember, these readings are taken by human beings, right?
Yes.
So in Kampala, we have over 400,000 accounts. And we've tried to organize ourselves in a number of branches. So Kampala alone, we have 28 branches. When I talk about Kampala, like I said, it has Kampala City, it has parts of Wakiso, it has parts of what? Mukono. It's that big. To an extent, we have a radius of around 30 kilometers.
That's Kampala Metropolitan.
So we have 400,000 customers, different categories. We have the domestic users, we have the commercial institutions, we have the schools, we have a number of, like almost five categories of customers. Now what we've tried to do, again, to be a bit more efficient, we've organized ourselves into 200 territories. So it's what we call a territory.
Yes.
And the territory has 2,000 accounts. So we have a team of three people who are responsible for 2,000 customers. So this group includes a meter reader. It includes the person we call a commercial assistant or a territorial leader. And then we have a plumber. Our motto is that the territory is our operational unit. So we have to make sure that the territory is as efficient as possible. So the person who reads the meter is responsible to make sure that he captures the right what? The right readings on the customer's meter.
Yes.
And you see these customers, we have a schedule from the start of the month to the end of the month when they're supposed to read which meter. So in most cases, for most of the accounts, we're able to visit it once. Yeah. So when these people capture the readings, they're put into the system. Yeah. And actually it's on spot. Yeah. You go to the customer's premises, you capture reading, it's automatically captured into the what? Into the system. Now the system is in such a way that if the reading is erroneous, yeah, that means that it is not rhyming with the previous what? Readings. The system will flag it. Yeah, it will flag it. So when it flags it, it means that now the territory leader has the responsibility to go and investigate it and check it out. So we have, what I'm trying to bring out is that we have checks and balances to ensure that by the end of the day, when the customer gets a reading, it is correct. Now, you're going to have still cases where you find at the end of the month, the reading doesn't reflect what is on the ground. Now, the percentages, we've been checking how many estimates we have. They're not even 2% at the end of the month. So what happens at the end of the day, if you talk about the procedure, in the event you confirm and investigate, you find that there was a problem with that account, again, we have a system to have to correct it so that it doesn't happen again.
But do you agree that there are customers who are not billed, then there are those who are overbilled, and there are those who are underbilled? Does that happen?
Every customer, yes. As long as you're in our system, you're billed. You understand? Otherwise, then if you're not billed, either your account is not in the system, because the system is able to show you how many, and we've been billing 100% of our accounts, and we have the record. So every customer in principle is what? Is billed. Now, you're saying the customers who are overbilled. Now, we need to put overbilling into context, because sometimes when you talk about it, you might think it's intentional. So a customer can, because it's how a person looks at it, I can believe that I think I'm overbilled. And we've had cases where a customer says that I think my bill is not what? Is not right. Now, we take it up as a corporation. We work with the customer. We go on the ground with the customer. We do an investigation. What we found out in some cases, again, not all cases, we find that the customer has a leakage after the meter. Remember, National Water, in principle, our responsibility stops at the what? At the meter. When it comes to the connection, usually the customer is the one who does the internal plumbing of the home. You understand? You do whatever happens. For us, what we do is to come and connect the what? The meter. But after the meter, you've done all the plumbing. So the experience we've had with a number of customers, they say, my bill is high. Our team is sent on the ground. We investigate. We find that, one, the person has a leakage after the meter. Now, if that leakage is there, definitely it's going to affect your what? Your bill. And you're going to, it won't be that you've been overbilled, but to be that you have a high what? A high bill. And once, in most cases, once those leakages have been fixed, the bill comes back to normal. So the context of overbilling, I don't want it to come out like it is intentional. Sometimes it's coming out as a result that they find that sometimes the customer has a leakage after the meter. And then once we have that fixed, you find that the reading comes back to normal.
Then how about these reports of inflated bills? I want to understand how that maybe happened internally.
I think the case of inflated bills has been discussed, and I think feedback was officially given. It's the case that police is what? Is handling and investigating, and I think to be good. But I think on the side of the corporation, and this is the assurance we're giving the customer, the most important thing, the meter, we always say the meter is the responsibility of the what? The customer. We come to visit that meter once a month. So it means that you have this meter for the rest of the what? The month. So if we have the intention of inflating, yeah? You have the what? The meter. And we've tried to empower most of our customers to be in charge even of their bills. To the extent that some customers, and we'd encourage every customer, they're capturing the readings on even a daily basis, even on a weekly basis, just to assure you that at the end of the day, by the time you get your bill, you actually even know what your bill is going to be. No one should tell you that a staff of National is going to come, yeah, and manipulate the meter. Yet you have the meter for 29 what? If it was the case that we carry the meter and bring it to you, they would be very worried. But the meter is at your home. Yeah? You actually can read it every day. And you can ask all these questions. What you've tried to do is that when you go to our website, you've created a platform that when you pick a reading from your meter, you can patch into the system. It can even give you the actual reading or bill that you expect to get at the month. So once you have that, then you can cross-check with what our people have given you. So that's the kind of system and trust we want our customers to have.
So that's like self-billing?
Self-billing.
Yes.
And we are praying that at one day, time is going to come when actually, if you build that level of trust, we don't even have to come to your home. All you have to do, you'll be the one sending us the what? The reading. You know, when you develop that level of trust to the extent that I don't have to come to read the meter, why should I come if I can trust you? So all it can be that every month, the customer, and some countries are doing that, every month the customer sends the what? The billing to the utility. They call it bill your, read your meter. So you read the meter, take a photo and send it to us. So we don't even have to come. But it comes when you've developed that level of trust. And for us, that's where we are going as an organization, that we give you the meter, we even give you the tools to predict your what? Your bill. So there's never any intention for the corporation to do what? To inflate or even overbill you. It doesn't make any sense.
Okay, then talk to us about the prepaid system.
Yeah.
Have you rolled it out to some entities? Should the public expect to see that prepaid system like we do with the Akao Umeme?
I think we've had a lot of discussion on the aspect of prepaid meters, and I think so many customers have come out to request that it would be more convenient for them if we had prepaid meters. I think before we discuss whether we can have one or we might not have one, is to understand what does a prepaid meter do?
Yes.
Yeah. So I think in our context...
And is it already in operation?
Yeah, yeah, I'm going to come to that.
Okay.
What a prepaid meter, basically the benefit gives us as a utility that helps you collect the what? It helps you in debt management or collection, revenue collection. It means that you have most of your customers paying in what? In advance. So for the utility, that will be the biggest what? Advantage. On top of that, there are always arguments that it helps you reduce the theft, but that's a different story. Then on the side of the customer, a prepaid meter helps you to manage your what? Your water bill. It also helps you to be a bit more disciplined. You understand? So that's what it does to you. More or less, it gives you more convenience. Yeah. So, but right now, the biggest challenge is when you look at the advantages for the customer and also the advantage for the utility, you realize that the cost, yeah, right now the cost of a prepaid meter for water, because I think I won't discuss the prepaid for electricity because the utilities are kind of what? Different. We can't here discuss water the same way we're going to discuss what? Electricity, in terms of technology you need. So for water, right now that technology is still very, very what? Expensive. A normal meter that you have, those mechanical meters, the conventional meters that we're giving customers, it costs us around $25. So it means that's why most times when you're buying, when you're applying for a connection, you pay for that meter. It's your meter and you take responsibility for it. So a customer pays like 100,000, yeah, shillings for the meter. Now, a prepaid meter for domestic, if we ever start using them,
yes,
right now they're on average of like 1 million. So if we are to bring them, it means that a customer, to get a connection, you'll have to pay what? Just for the meter alone,
yes,
you have to pay 1 million.
Which is a lot of money
for most Ugandans.
Yes.
And then you look at, like I said, I started with, what does it give you? One, it gives the customer what? Convenience. That's why we're trying to implement solutions that are going to give that customer convenience. As right now, as of now, alternatives, as we get to the time, I'm sure time is going to come when the cost of the prepaid meter is going to come down and to be affordable. But as of now, it's very expensive. Now, on side of the corporation, like I said, one of the biggest advantage it gives you is to manage what? Collection. Because people are able to pay in advance. Now, the relationship we've had, the customer care we have had as an institution, you find that we're able to collect 100% of what we bill for most of our customers.
Do you?
So, yeah, yeah.
You don't have defaulters?
Majority, on average, we collect 100%.
But
for non-government, the discussion is different when we talk about government what accounts. So on average, largely, we have our collection efficiency hasn't been very bad. We're able to collect most of the money that we what? We bill for most of our customers. So again, it means that the advantage a prepaid gives you is not our biggest what?
Biggest worry.
So our biggest problem as a corporation and also as a country is that we're still in a position whereby a number of Ugandans don't have access to what? To water. And
to
that's when you look
water.
At the agenda
they,
for national water.
They do
water
have
is
access to some other sources of water, maybe springs,
yeah,
wells,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
which
yeah.
is not
Now,
looking
at the bigger picture of Uganda,
yes.
you still have people who don't have access to what? To water. So as a country, where would our priorities be?
Just
so the
before,
priorities
just
be
before we get,
to get
before
a,
we
to
get
go,
to
go
the,
high tech or to make sure that every Ugandan has water.
Just before we get to the entire country and the plans you have for us for those areas that don't have clean water, what are those entities that are using
yeah.
the prepaid
I was coming
system?
To that. So as National Water, we've tried to prioritize where do we put prepaid meters. I'm not saying we're not using them, we're using them. So a number of two areas largely we focused to use prepaid meters. One, we have prepaid meters being used in urban poor areas. So you find in areas of Kisenyi where you put the public taps. So some of those public taps are using prepaid meters. And the way those prepaid meters are working that they commit the households, because you can have one tap serving maybe 5 or 10 households. So what we do is that every household is given a token, which becomes now the card where you put your credit.
Yeah.
Now, anytime you want water, you go and use that card to draw the water. And a jerrycan on those points, because of the system, at least you're able to charge, you charge 25 shillings for a 20-liter jerrycan. That's why they're very advantageous for us, purposely to make sure they're helping us ensure that at least the disadvantaged communities where we serve are able to get water at only 25 shillings.
Yes.
Now the other area where I've used the prepaid meters is largely on government institutions. And again, government came out because that's why, like I said in the beginning, prepaids help you to manage what? Debt and collect revenue. And I think that's one area where we had a big challenge with what? With collection. So government came out and said that let's have prepaids put on most of the government what? Institutions. And the biggest argument was that they should help us collect the what? The arrears or the money. So every institution ideally would have to pay in advance because they have quarter releases. Whatever money is allocated to water would have to be paid promptly. So that was the intention. But along the way, still, we've had a number of cases that you find that an institution doesn't have money,
yeah.
but there's no way you can what? Because with a prepaid meter, once you haven't paid, don't have credit, supposed to disconnect you. So though we have prepaid meters, we've ended up using them like what? Because the institutions are not able to pay in advance because of the challenges that exist within the economic situation we are running. So at the end of the day, as National Water, we've had to exercise the flexibility to not insist that if you don't have credit, we're not going to give you water. So sometimes if they don't have credit, we've discussed with them and we give them credit in advance.
And yeah. are those the entities that usually default while the private citizens are paying?
I wouldn't use the word default.
Yes.
Yeah. Because default means that
they pay
you
argue,
you argue that it's intentional. Mm-hmm. But sometimes you see most of these entities are government and they rely on what? The tax collection. So as long as we have challenges in the economy, definitely they're going to be affected and definitely we're going to be affected. So I think the most important thing is to understand that we are operating in, that's why water at the end of the day, for most of the countries, water is always a government what? Responsibility.
Yes.
And most of the institutions are owned by government. And as a corporation, we have that responsibility to properly network and engage with all those stakeholders to make sure that where there's a challenge, we appreciate it, yeah? And we see how we can still continue providing our customers with reliable services.
Yes, it is on this note that I want to engage you specifically because the bills that we're talking about that got inflated were in some of these institutions because it hit the prepaid system. And the MD, the Managing Director of National Water, Engineer Dr. Silva Mudusha, had said that they were the mafias who were going about this. So who are these mafias? Do you know them?
I think what he meant, you know, the term mafia has different definitions. Mm-hmm. and contentions for different what? Institution. In our case, the mafias, the way we define mafias are people who, because when stealing water is legal, it's a criminal act. Yeah? So the people who are intentionally very organized and they are stealing what? Water. And we're not saying government institutions are stealing water. That's not the point. But the point is that our experience has shown that there's a group, especially when it comes to the commercial institutions, because they want to save as much as possible. So they found ways of manipulating and tampering with the meters. So for purposes of making sure that we bill them less. So that's the group that we're dealing, that's the biggest challenge we are dealing with in Nashonta. And I think MD highlighted that you find that out of the water, if we produce 100 units in Kampala, we're only able to sell around 60
yes.
units. It means that the 40 is part of it is largely what?
Is lost
through such cases of people intentionally stealing, and they do it in different ways. Yeah, like I said, there are people who have found ways. They know when you use the magnet, it can affect the functionality of the what? The meter. There are people who have opened these meters. Yeah, and they've tried to play, because these are mechanical what? Equipment. You open it, and you've seen even cars. You can open the dial of the car and see how it can't what? Move. So they found ways of tampering with the meters, so that at the end of the month, like I told you, our staff come to your home once in a what? In a month, on one day, and they spend less than even 10 minutes at your home. So it means that the rest of the month, you decide what happens to the meter. So some people remove the meter, put it inside the house, and they connect directly. You understand? People are doing that. So they know when you're coming. When you come back, they put it back. Then they tell you, the reading of the meter is this. But remember, for almost 10 days, the water was not going through the meter. It was connected directly. People are doing that. And people know. We're talking about this thing is happening. At night, people bypass the what? The meter, and they fill their tanks. Once the tank is full, he puts back. You come in the morning, you find the meter is okay. But you see the home has a tank that is 10,000. But the meter reads you 2 units. How? How did he fill the tank? Wait, you know it's dry completely, not even rain. Today the people tell you it has been raining. Yet you know it hasn't what? This is reality. And when he talked about it, he's trying to, and the beauty is that most of us are experiencing it, because most of the information we get regarding people stealing water is coming from the public. So people call you and tell you that our neighbor at night fills the tank. That's how our people come. Together we partnered with police to fight this problem. We have a full dedicated police officers, almost 30 in Kampala,
yes.
whom we work with our teams, and we've created teams. These teams go out to deal with such cases. So you have people who remove the meter.
Yes.
There are people even who reverse. They know when you put the meter in the reverse and water goes through it, it reads what? Backwards. Yeah? So unfortunately, when you discuss this, then people are going to start now testing how this works. Yeah, but these are challenges we're dealing with. And when you talked about that, especially for some of the big consumers, and I can't put names, but the records are here. Every month in Kampala, we get almost 300 people stealing water. Every month. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And the records are there. They're fine. Someone is fine today. Tomorrow, he does it again. He's fine tomorrow, then he does it what? Again. So it's a fight, and we've talked about it, that we're trying to engage with. The beauty is that we're not alone. We're dealing with it with police and other safety agencies to make sure that this problem is solved. But also we need the public to come on board, because not everyone is a thief, definitely.
Yes, they're
customers who are very genuine.
Mm.
And
the
majority,
neighbors who call you and say...
Yeah, exactly. Majority of our customers are very, very what? Genuine. Like, experience has shown that the people are stealing are not the ordinary people. They are the rich people. You understand? So what we're talking about is not...
I think that's an irony.
Yeah, it's a challenge. You ask yourself why.
Mm.
Because a person is fetching a jerry can from a tap. Why would he steal? Because he buys a jerry can for five... Some of them even pay a lot of money for a jerry can. So those are not the people we're talking about. The people we're talking about is the person, he knows, we put a meter there. Even they open it, they cut the gears of the meter and can't move. Even however much water you pump, the meter is what? Is looking at you, doesn't move. So those are the issues. Now, with the argument of whether it's the corporation actually tampering and inflating, yeah? If we're the one who are inflating, then we wouldn't say that we are losing 40%. Because we would intentionally make sure that whatever is lost is what? Is recovered. But that's not the spirit. We believe that this problem, we can deal with it. And we can deal with it by engaging the public, having such this kind of program, so that when you're out there and you see your neighbor, yeah, there's a person who can call you that, hey, this neighbor even doesn't get a water bill, but he has water. Where is he getting the water from? That's the kind of information we need, because we need to deal with this problem. The people stealing affecting the many genuine Ugandans who are actually paying their bills genuinely.
Oh no. So are you losing this battle to these mafias?
I think as a country and as a utility and as a government, I don't think we're ever going to lose this battle. Because I think there are measures that it started with, how do you work with police? And we have a very strong relationship by how we are dealing with it. We brought on board other security agencies to deal with it. But also we're trying to bring on board technology, because I think where the world is moving with better technology, some of the issues that people are doing, they won't be able to do them.
Mm. On a scale of 1 to 5, how much or how do you think, what kind of impacts do these mafias make on your service delivery?
I'll talk about in terms of the loss, and I think it was hinted by Dr. Silva. If the corporation was able, because he gave a figure that every month maybe we lose 2 billion in theft, and he argued that if we're able to, say, recover that money as a corporation, right now Nashota is operating in 262 towns across the country. The discussion is not just in Kampala alone. You know, when you discuss national water, unfortunately, we get the feeling that we discuss in Kampala. No, we're discussing Moroto, we're discussing Bara, we're discussing Lira, we're discussing almost 260 towns where we operate. Now, what has always happened is that most cases, Kampala is our big what? Is our cash cow as a corporation. It means that the money we make in Kampala is what is helping us provide services in upcountry towns. So you get money from Kampala, extend services in Gulu, extend services in Lira, take services in Moroto. So if we can increase our financial capacity in Kampala, it means that we can serve more Ugandans as a corporation. So the impact the people who are stealing water are having on national water is not that they're not affecting national water as national water, but they're affecting the whole what? Country. They're denying the people who are not having water the opportunity to be able to get water also, just like the point Kampala.
Yes. Moving on to the Kato C plant that recently got completed. Is it complete?
Yeah, Kato C was completed.
It was completed. So yeah, we are receiving water from Kato C as well. And we still have some rationing going on in some areas in Kampala. Why?
Why? So Kato C was completed. I think we need, again, I always like to rewind back, because I don't want us to forget where we come from. I would say 3 years ago, 2 years ago, before July 2021, we had one of our biggest challenges, especially during this period of January in Kampala, was water. Because we only had one source of water, that was Gaba. Now Gaba, every day, we're able to produce 240 million liters per day. Now the demand for Kampala alone was around 300 million liters a day. So it means that what we're producing was not enough to satisfy the demand. That was a general problem in Kampala. So places like Nsasa, I always quote Nsasa because for me it was one of the biggest challenges. We'd only give them water on Tuesday. So they knew Nsasa people get water on what?
Tuesday.
And they wait Tuesday, they look at Tuesday as the, you know, the way you're waiting for something. And then boom, if you haven't got water Tuesday, you wait for another what? So that's how bad
another
it was.
Tuesday. That was and, really terrible.
Until Kato C came on board. Mm. We commissioned Kato C in July 2021. And from 240 million liters per day, Kato C added 160 million liters per day. So what means that Kampala, we have the capacity to produce 400 million liters per day. That is as far as production is concerned. So it means that we have enough water to meet the demand of what? Kampala. That is a fact.
Now, very interesting. Let's go for a short break.
Okay.
Then when we return, he's going to be telling us if our plants are producing or treating enough water for us to use, then why are there rations in some areas of Kampala? Let's be back.